Okay, welcome again, everyone. My name is Shayna Jacques. I am the outreach manager for PSS of Cove Care. I just wanted to welcome everyone and say Happy New Year. It's a new year. We're going to focus on presenting more webinar, more topic to you, to the community, and then we're very thankful for you to participate. And like I said, if you have any question, if you have any recommendation that you might, it's a topic that might be an interest to you, please reach out to me. Send an email, and if any topic that we can provide to you, we'll definitely try to accommodate everybody. Again, welcome. Some of you already know about PSS. Okay, let's always do that. Jeez. I'm just going to use this one like that. So today's webinar title is the right word, how to discuss next step. So our presenter and returning presenter, thank you again, Cynthia, is Cynthia Perthuis. She's a certified senior advisor, an elder care strategist at Senior Care Authority. So Cynthia finds that client often has trouble finding the right words. As a result, she has developed a script to help them stay on track with either a parent or other member of the family. In this webinar today, she will present a script template and step as well as case study that will be helpful in order to find the right word for tricky situation. If some of you might know about PSS already, but I'm just going to do a quick overview about our agency. So it's been founded in 1962. We are a multi-service agency who has for mission to strengthen the capacity of older New Yorkers and their family. PSS / University, it's a program that offers educational program to our 10 local center, and also webinars is part of PSS / University. It's designed to help older adults stay healthy, engaged, and connected. PSS has different resources and services. One of them is PSS of Care that I'm currently working under, that provides free personal support for those caring for someone who's frail, chronically ill, or has a memory loss issues. We also have a kinship program where we have family, whether a grandparent or family member other than a parent is raising a child. We also have our coming of age program that inspires people 50 plus to live with passion and purpose. So as I mentioned before, if you have any question, because I can't, for some reason, we cannot allow, I guess it's a Zoom setting that I cannot allow people to talk, but if you do have a question, you can directly to the Q&A box, right, Q&A, or I will monitor the chat room. So if you add a question there, I can just read it to Cynthia, or if it's regarding our services to be assessed, I will answer those questions. Okay, for more information, and if you want to participate more, we do have a variety of services if you want to learn more about it. So you can reach out to visit our website. For PSS of Care, it's pssaregiver.org. Coming of age is comingofagenyc.org. Of course, all the classes and event are listed on pssusa.org/event, and of course you can learn more about our centers, our volunteer program, and this webinar has been recorded and we will post it on our website. To find more resources, pssusa.org/resources. Okay, again, thank you. So Cynthia, you ready? You can start your PowerPoint. Here you go. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Perfect. Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, great. So thank you, Shayna. Good afternoon, and thank you for joining me this afternoon for a really important topic. So it's titled Finding the Right Words How to Have the Conversation. I'm Cynthia Perthuis, and I am an elder care strategist and owner of Senior Care Authority. Today, I'm going to walk you through a fairly comprehensive laundry list of pointers. You plan to talk to your neighbor either in the home or living. My team helps older people find a safe and healthy living option when they are ready to find a community that caters to their specific wants and needs. We also work with families that want their loved one to stay home, but need help with all the required resources. We work with people in the five boroughs of New York and the southwest coast of Florida. We work with a nationwide network, and we can help support life and living choices anywhere in the United States and Canada. So, for those of you that have heard my presentations before, you know that I like to start with a musical reference. My last presentation on patient advocacy used the Beatles and their song Help. Today, my reference is Meghan Trainor. One of my team members reminded me that she was 66 years old and had never heard of Meghan Trainor. However, my 35-year-old son suggested this one for me and for this presentation. So as a nod to the Generation X, I will tell you about Meghan. She is 37 and has won a Grammy. Her most popular songs are All About That Bass and These Lips Are Movin'. She's a judge on The Voice in the UK. Whoever Meghan is, I sing along very loudly with the chorus of this song when I hear it on the radio. It's all about the word no. I hope that when you are having a difficult conversation with your loved one, the memory of these words will bring a smile to your face. My name is no, my sign is no, my number is no, you need to let it go. Helping an older person choose to move from their home or accept in-home care is never easy. I cannot count the number of times I had this moving conversation with my father during his battle with Alzheimer's. I can, however, count the number of times I had the conversation with my mother before she died. Exactly 2 times. Neither time was pleasant, and neither time ended up the way that I wanted it to end up. It ended the way my mother wanted it to end. But that does not mean that it was what was best for her or what was best for the family or best for anyone else. I did not have the tools nor the time to have the conversation in a productive manner. I'm here today to give you the tools and help you find the time to have a successful outcome. And as you see on this slide, 77% of adult children believe their parents are stubborn about taking their advice or getting help with daily problems. And I have to assume that most of you on this call agree that your parents or your loved ones are stubborn about taking your advice. We're gonna look at a couple of case studies during our time today. You will probably see familiar situations in both of these case studies. We won't solve all of the issues in each of these studies, but I want you to keep them in mind as we walk through the presentation. So let's talk about Michael and Sue. Michael and Sue were high school sweethearts, and they've been married for 75 years. They're both in their 90s. They live in the same home that they've lived in for 45 years. They've raised 3 children. They have grandchildren, great-grandchildren. They have a very large family. 2 of the adult children live over 500 miles away in separate cities, but they visit on holidays. 1 adult child lives fairly close and is the power of attorney and really the go-to support system. All 3 of the children and their spouses have full-time careers and other family responsibilities. I'm sure you've heard this story or seen this. In the past year, there have been several causes for concern. Michael, the husband, has been falling periodically during the night. There are 3 steps up to the front door and a staircase to the bedroom, and there's been much difficulty navigating those stairs. Sue has been lightheaded and weak, and she doesn't remember taking her medicine. There seems to be outdated food in the refrigerator, and Michael and Sue don't ever seem to be hungry, and they're not eating well. Sue has had repeated UTIs, and they've also lost touch with many of their friends because of their health and mobility issues. In our business, we see this on a regular basis. So, when you're having the conversation, there are several words that must stay top of mind. Those words are respect, love, honor, wisdom, and above all, patience. Today, we're going to go through the different steps to prepare for the conversation. It's important that you try to work through each of these steps, not necessarily in this order, but in some semblance of this order. We're going to learn to identify the players, identify the challenges, identify the objections, identify the resources, identify different methods, plan the conversation, and then set the stage. All of these things need to be taken care of before you ever speak words to your loved one. So identify the players. Who's the decision maker in the family dynamic? Who can be the calmest to lead the discussion? Who's going to be the wild card? Who's going to take the opposite side and say all of these things don't work? Who's not going to even show up for a meeting? The family dynamics need to be sorted out. A recent study shows that 2/3 of caregivers were women, the women in the family. Traditionally, the oldest daughter leads the process. However, the family must make these decisions and be involved and supportive. Let's look at some resources that can help with those families. It never hurts to have a backup. Elder care strategists are trained at facilitating these meetings. They will charge for this service, but it can be invaluable to have an outsider work through the situation with the family. Other resources include financial and legal professionals. They can bring facts and figures to the table. Clergy and physicians are usually respected and listened to. Friends and extended family can provide much needed support. So it's very important to circle these people around you as you're going through this process. What are the challenges in this situation? Get these all on paper and talk through them. Your challenges may not be your parents' challenges, and they may not be your siblings' challenges. Try to make sure that all parties have an opportunity to speak and are shown respect. Commit that everyone is listening and only one person is speaking at a time. If the discussions get heated, take a break. Make a list. Do not interrupt other people. Does your loved one have an unrealistic understanding of the situation? Do they have fears about moving that are unfounded? This slide speaks to some of the myths about assisted living as an example. Your loved one may be fearful of their loss of independence and privacy, fearful of being abandoned, the food is bad, they play bingo all day long, and I'm not old enough to go to assisted living. This slide gives you some of the truth around some of those myths. For whatever challenges and obstacles that you're facing, you need to try to find those facts and figures that can answer these questions. So, bad food. Most communities have excellent chefs, and there's a food committee of residents that help manage the menu. There are even happy hours weekly at most communities. So you see where we've taken the myths and the urban legends from the first slide and found the answers to those earths and those myths and urban legends on this second slide. And then I would advise you to build a table with both sides of the story. Your loved one, your parent may say, I want my independence. And your solution is you can keep your independence. This is simply the help for you to have more freedom. I've lived in my home for 50 years. The solution could be that the maintenance costs are continuing to rise and it's very expensive. And it's also dangerous. There are stairs, there are rugs, there are things that are not conducive to living at a certain age in a home that has been lived in for 50 years. I do not have the money. You know, you worked hard all of your life for your money. We don't want your money. This is a way to celebrate your success and give you some happiness and ease of mind in your later years. These objection tables can be really, really long, but you want to prepare and think about all of the objections that you're going to come across in your discussions. There are a number of different methods and skills that are needed to have these conversations. So you need to be aware of these different types. When you negotiate, everyone involved must give up something. Maybe you would like for your parents to move in assisted living by the end of the month because you have a vacation. Well, maybe you have to move your vacation or wait until you return. Mediation requires flexibility and a consensual compromise. It's very informal, but it's also non-adversarial. Facilitation is about helping people reach consensus. However, consensus means that no one is exactly right and no one is exactly wrong, but you may agree to disagree on certain topics. And then a resolution is helping everyone find a peaceful conclusion. Keep in mind, you cannot force an adult to do anything. The only legal way to force someone is to go through guardianship, which is a long and expensive process. So think about yourself. When you're having a difficult conversation, what are the things that make you angry? Can hunger affect your anger level? Lack of sleep, loud noise, a lot of people, distractions? Make sure that you make a plan for your discussions with your parent or loved one. Maybe it works to have many small conversations over lunch or in a car. Make sure everyone's gone to the restroom. You don't want to have any excuses for not sitting and having this conversation. And make sure you have your facts and figures and your table with you of your objections, your challenges and your objections and your solutions. Practice these phrases in front of a mirror. Make sure they do not sound canned, but very sincere. Put your loved one's feelings first. Tell them, I'm worried about you. I want you to be safe. I want you to enjoy your life. I hear you. I understand why you would feel that way, but I'm looking for a way to help us both. Keep in mind, this is about your loved one and your parent. You're going to give them your thoughts about yourself, but it's about them and what is safe and best and healthy for that person. Not what is easier or more convenient for you. I think this slide is self-explanatory. Remember, the entire conversation and situation is surrounded by, while it's unspoken, it's surrounded by that difficult topic of mortality. While it may be covered with a look that it's about the food or about the independence, it's about the fact that we are all mortal and this is another step towards the end of life. Don't tell them they're being selfish and don't tell them that they're a burden. As I mentioned earlier, small conversations work well. I know this sounds like you're discussing things with your teenager, but remember that this person is more of an adult. However, some of these strategies work for all difficult conversations. Talk about it as often as you can before there is a crisis. Wait for a teachable moment. Maybe somebody else has fallen. Maybe you see an article in the newspaper. Maybe you're another relative or a neighbor or a friend has recently moved to assisted living, R has fallen. Don't be bossy. You also should refer to an authority. Bring in an authority. Blame an authority. You can say, you know, my attorney made me take away your car. Blame it on someone else. Do not walk in the door and act like you have an agenda. Do not look like there's only one answer. Don't push. Help your loved one or your parent feel like they're in control and ask for their input. On these next two slides, I've shown you examples of two articles that you could use for this discussion, or that'll give you some ideas of articles you might look, that you might find for yourself. These are recent articles, and this first one is on more elderly Americans dying from falls. This came out just about a month ago, and it shows that mortality from falls climbed 5.1% from 2000 to 2016. And this is that the death rates from falls rose the most in people at 95 and up. So we know that that hip is a leading indicator once you've fallen. And once you fall once, you can continue to fall more and more and lead into a sharp decline. And then this article came out almost a year ago. This one talking about the health effects of social isolation. So research shows that social isolation, no matter how historically unsocial you may be or your parent may be, it is as unhealthy as smoking one pack of cigarettes a day. This article gives you a list, they're underlined here, of mental and physical ailments that are exacerbated or caused by social isolation. So if we go back to our first case study, Michael and Sue, who couldn't really get out of the house and their friends weren't coming by anymore. Their decline, their blood pressure issues, their depression can be exacerbated by this social isolation. A script is very important. Write a script, stick to the script. Remember, you have done the homework. This sample is an excerpt of an actual script that my team wrote for a family. It takes into account the planning and strategizing that the leader of the family worked on with us. It speaks about the challenges. Each bullet point was really used as a smaller conversation. Each time the mother and daughter had a chance to talk, the daughter would remind the mother about the earlier discussion and the things that they had agreed to, and then she went to the next point. She did not rehash the earlier discussion. She didn't try to change her mother's mind from what they had agreed to in the earlier discussion. She didn't rush through the points. She was silent and listened when the mother wanted to move off track, and then she would gently return to the point. She kept the written script with her to be able to access it anytime, on the phone, at lunch, or more formally. She was able to keep herself directed by keeping in mind that she had these points that she wanted to point out to her mother. And she was able to get through this conversation in a few time periods, and it worked very successfully. But every script is customized and needs to be customized to your situation. These are just some ideas of some words and some ideas of some things that were important to this family. Be prepared for the hand grenades that will take you off script. Be understanding, tell them you hear them, and keep going back to the script. Be prepared to fail over and over again, and be prepared for disagreements and the hand grenades of I'd rather die than move. Those type of statements will come out along the way, and your best answer to that is, I hear you, I understand. Now, let's talk about some good things that would happen if you moved. You want to change the subject and not get drawn into these hand grenades that, that may be brought up during the conversation. Next, we're going to briefly discuss special situations, namely dementia. This case study looks at these situations, one of these situations. So John and Mary were both 85 years old. John had been diagnosed with Alzheimer's around 80, and he used a walker. Mary was very independent and was the primary caregiver for John. She used a variety of resources to make sure John was well cared for when she went out to her events and with her friends. And their two adult children lived just about 100 miles away and visited their parents often. However, once again, their children had full-time careers and their own families that created many responsibilities. One night, Mary suddenly died in her sleep. There was really no one to care for or manage the care for John. Everyone was in mourning over the loss of Mary, the mother and wife. Everyone was also at a loss over the loss of Mary, the caregiver. And John asked repeatedly when Mary would come home. Even when dealing with early or advanced cases of dementia, you should still go through all the steps and attempt to have the conversation. However, due to the nature of the disease, the loved one may not comprehend and may stay in a loop. And that loop may be no, no, no. In some cases, for the safety and well-being of your loved one, you may have to move on to what is termed therapeutic fibbing. Your goal is to make sure that they are in a safe place and that there is not a fire or a car accident or a tragedy that could harm them as well as innocent bystanders. At this point, you can tell them a story about why and how they will be moving. Their home needs major repair that requires them to be out of the way. Maybe it needs to be exterminated, updated, asbestos removed, new carpeting. You can tell them that you need a vacation or the caregiver needs a vacation and that they need to go someplace so there's someone to take care of them. You can suggest that they have a vacation. This method is the kindest way to provide safety. This is also another great time to use experts that can either propose the solution or agree with you and support you. So, what is next? I always like to ask the question, how do you eat an elephant? And as I'm sure you know, the answer is one bite at a time. There are really three buckets in this process, both during and after the conversation. Where will your loved one go? Will it be to stay at home with some help, or will it be to move to assisted living? If moving, where is the right place? When will they move or start home care? Is it immediately? Is it after a certain event, such as selling the home or moving to another city? You want to make sure that the when is not when there's a crisis, because that when could be too late. How will the change take place and how will it work? Is it about money? Is it about hiring the appropriate helper? Is it about finding a way to clean up the house? There are solutions to all of these questions and more. Build your team and they can help you get through this part. After a transition period, I cannot remember a time that I had a client tell me that they can't believe they made this change and that it's just been awful. More often, I hear these actual statements from my clients. My favorite is, it took a team of Clydesdale horses to drag me here. I wish someone had brought those horses to my house months ago. I can't believe the difference that a month makes. John started to bloom in the first week. He is like the man I knew several years ago. And then I'm not sure why we pushed so hard to get the cable installed. He hasn't watched TV in weeks because he is so busy. So remember, Dealing with a stubborn parent is not the same as dealing with a stubborn child. Remember to strategize with others. If it isn't working, change tactics or messengers. Don't repeat the same speech over and over, but keep the same principles in that speech. You may have to draw a hard line. If they don't accept help, then you may have to step away and not offer help so that they see how much help they do need and that you may not be able to be there every time. Review the steps, follow the process. It may seem onerous, but your conversations will be more productive if you can stay calm and focused and if you did your homework. So we're going to stop here for a moment, and if you have questions, then you can put them in the Q&A box or you can put them in the chat and I will attempt to help you. Remember, this is a personalized plan, but there are some things that are common among all of these conversations.
We had a question earlier, Cynthia, about if the PowerPoint will be available to everybody.
I can send the PowerPoint to you and then it will also be posted on the PSS website.
Okay. If you have a question, you can just add it to, if anybody has a question, you can just add it to the Q&A box or the chat, because for some reason, I cannot allow you to talk when you raise your hand. It will be easier for us to find your, to answer your question.
Sometimes a question that I get is, how long does this process take? So how long from the time I decide I'm going to talk to my mother, how long should I give it before we're at the end of the process? And I will tell you that there is no time calendar that you can put on it. It takes, it can take a while. Sometimes when you open the door to this conversation, you'll find that your parent or your loved one is very interested in having this conversation and has just been waiting for you to have it and for you to say it. They were embarrassed. They didn't know how to say it. They didn't want you to feel like they were weak. And Carolyn, on how can I be reached, you'll see on the final page, I'll flip down to that right now, maybe. There is my email address and feel free to send me an email. And then I will also, when I send everyone's the PowerPoint, you'll all have my contact information.
There's a question on the chat box, Cynthia.
Okay, let me go find it. For some reason, I don't see the chat box. Can you?
Yes, okay, I can read it to you.
Okay.
So Jody asks question, do you think that it is helpful to bring the person to the location to see what they are like?
I do believe that is important to do. And we recommend not, or my team recommends not bringing them to the location until you have done a tour yourself with an expert who has shown you the possible locations. And you've brought it down to a reasonable, manageable number of locations, which would be not more than two. And so maybe you go look at three or four with an expert who can help you through that process. And then you bring your loved one, your parent to one, maybe two, and you explain to them, you've done all of this research. That is after the conversation. You don't want to spring on them that you're going to take them to look at assisted living when you haven't got their buy-in that might be something that's okay. But we do not recommend that you make that phone call and that you take them to four or five assisted livings and they've never been to an assisted living It is tiring. It is overwhelming. It is scary. Okay, well, I know you're going to come up with some more questions. So I want to make I want to make sure that you are that you feel free to send me an email or give me a call at the numbers that are on the screen. I want to thank you so much for your time and attention. I know that you took away at least one piece of new information. Again, feel free to email me or call me. I definitely want to thank PSS Circle of Care for the opportunity. I do some, I see a question that came up here. You mentioned that no matter how long someone has been a loner, they need interaction. But some people, no matter what technique you use, they will not interact. Have you ever encountered this, and how did you approach the problem? So I have not encountered it myself because some of my team call me an elder whisperer because I have a way of dancing and getting some interaction from my clients. At the same time, I'm only interacting with my clients for a short period of time before they go to assisted living. And in assisted living communities, as well as in in-home situations sometimes, there is, these people are specialists. Again, you're not going to take a loner and they're going to be the king of the Scrabble board. You're not going to have a loner and they're going to be the person who arranges the trip to see the Rockettes in New York City for the holidays. They're not going to flip overnight like that, and they never will. However, they will begin to have this interaction because they will find like-minded people. And maybe that interaction is just sitting with two people who are loners, but they're both reading in a place where they can see what's going on around them and the community being active. So there are different types of interaction, and that interaction may be being active, but that interaction could also be just being in a place where other people are moving around and gives them something of interest to watch. So it's a slow and easy process. Still time for questions.
Yeah, there's still time for question. But as you mentioned, if any question comes to your mind after this presentation, you can directly contact Cynthia for more information. And also you can reach out to me. Cynthia, for just a few minutes, I'm just gonna share my last screen.
Okay.
Just to have PSS resources, if anybody needs any more information about our services, this is where you can go and find the information. My name again is Shayna Jacques. My email is sjacques, and I know a lot of you received my email when you registered. Please feel free to give me a call or send me an email, okay? And also, Cynthia, you said you will have the PowerPoint. When I send the list to you, you can share it to everybody, right?
Yes, I will.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thanks again.
Sometime, but I believe we don't have any more questions. But thank you again. And Happy New Year to everybody again. And talk to you soon. If any question, please direct it to Cynthia.
Thank you.
Okay. Have a great day, everyone.